Hi, welcome to Type 2 Diabetes number 16. Today we're going to talk about a class of medications that force your beta cells to release insulin. Now, this was a question from an excellent subscriber that always writes good comments on my videos. So, thank you. She basically wants to know how Glybride works. Now, Glybride, just like Glimepiride and Glipizide and, you know, a lot of other ides, they belong to a class of medications called Sulfonylureas. And today, we're going to see how they work. Now, always remember that if you should take medications or not is between you and your doctor. My goal is to explain to you clearly how they work so that you can understand some of the pros and cons of taking these medications or, you know, any other medication. Now, how do these sulfonylureas like Glyburide and Glipizide work? I told you that when you eat, your blood sugar goes up, right? And this glucose will get inside the beta cells of the pancreas and force them to release insulin. Now, I always say that glucose will force the beta cells to release insulin, right? Because it's not like your beta cells will just be sitting around and go like, okay, I think this guy just ate a piece of cake, so let's just release some insulin to take care of it. No, glucose will personally get inside the beta cells to get the job done. So let's take one beta cell outside. Let's say that this is a beta cell from the pancreas. Now, the way it works is that glucose has a private jet, like I told you before. Glucose can enter inside the beta cells and they will be metabolized and converted to energy. Now, ATP is the energy currency of the body. You know, cells don't use cash, you know, but I think a lot of people are not using cash nowadays. So anyway, now ATP is the energy currency of the body. Now, on the surface of your beta cells, there are two channels, one and two. Now, the first one is a potassium channel. This channel is sensitive to ATP. This channel is normally open so that potassium that is positively charged can get out of the cells, can leave the cells to keep the cells cool, you know, relaxed. I know the technical term is polarized, but I just say cool because they literally keep the cells cool. All these positive ions will get out of the cells and the cells inside the cells will be cool and relaxed and the cell will not do anything. We just stay there. Now, when there's a lot of energy inside the cells, a lot of this ATP, ATP can block these channels. And potassium cannot go out. And I told you, potassium is positive. So a lot of positive charges will start building up inside the cells. And the cells will start getting hot. Again, the technical term is depolarized, but I say hot because they literally get hot. There's a lot of electricity building up inside the cells. And there's another channel that can sense the electricity. And these calcium channels, they can sense the voltage. They can sense that the cells are getting hot. When the cells are getting depolarized, these channels will open and a lot of calcium will start getting inside the cells. And this calcium will make sure that the insulin vesicles that are already here will get linked to the membrane. And a lot of this insulin will be released. Well, let me just change the color of the insulin to not confuse you. Now, when insulin is released, you know that insulin will make sure that this glucose can enter different cells in your body, especially muscle cells and fat cells, where they can be used for energy or they can be stored as glycogen and fat. But we already know that. So someone said, wait, if we close this channel, insulin will surely be released. Why don't we just make something that we take and we call medications that will come all the way here and block this channel? And this is what Glyburide does. Well, actually, the first medications that were found to close these channels, they were discovered by accident. But later, they made these Glyburides and Glipizides and other ides that can come all the way here and block these channels. When they block these channels, you know what will happen. The cells will get hot, these channels will sense it, and then a lot of calcium will get inside the cells and insulin is released. Now, with this understanding, what are some of the pros and cons of taking these medications? Now, the first positive thing about these medications is that they work right away. They're not trying to reduce your insulin resistance and maybe later try to improve your blood glucose or this or that. No, they just go straight to your beta cells, close these channels, and make sure they release insulin. Insulin will take care of the glucose right away. So they just work fast, faster than other medications. And they generally reduce your A1C better than most other diabetes medication. And patients are normally happy with these medications, you know, because they will go like, my blood sugar used to go to 300 when I eat. But now with these medications, they don't even reach 150. So they tend to be happy because they see the results right away. Now, another thing about these medications is that they're cheap. They're one of the first ones to be developed for type 2 diabetes. And they're normally very cheap and everyone can afford them. But there are a lot of things about these medications that make me not like them so much. Now, the first one is that they can cause hypoglycemia. And the reason why is that, as I told you, glucose can force your beta cells to release insulin, right? These medications can also force your beta cells to release insulin, right? But the difference is that the entering of glucose into your beta cells is dependent on the concentration of glucose. So if there's a lot of glucose will get inside the beta cells and a lot of insulin will be released. But if there's very little glucose, less glucose will enter the beta cells and less insulin will be released. But when it comes to these medications, the amount of insulin that is released is not dependent on the concentration of glucose. For example, if the dose is too much, maybe a lot of insulin will be released. It doesn't matter if your glucose is high or low. These medications will just go and close the channel and the insulin will be released. So with these medications, if you take a little bit more than what you need, a lot of insulin will come and you might have hypoglycemia. Or let's say you eat a different meal that does not raise your blood sugar to match the level of the medication. You might have hypoglycemia. Let's say you skip a meal and you do not skip the medication. You will have hypoglycemia because they will just go straight to your beta cells and force them to release insulin independent on the concentration of glucose. So that's why patients that are taking Glyburide and Glipizide and Glimepiride and all these IDEs, they're normally told to walk with, you know, some kinds of sugar in their pockets just in case something goes, you know. Now, the second negative thing about these medications is that they can cause weight gain. As I told you, they will force the beta cells to release insulin, right? And you know that insulin is an anabolic hormone. Insulin will get glucose inside different cells, mostly muscle cells and fat cells. And they will be used for energy or stored as glycogen and fat. Now, let's say that you are someone who's very active and you know with a lot of muscles and you do a lot of exercise. Maybe most of them will go to muscle cells. But let's say you're someone who just sits on the couch. Then a lot of this glucose will go to fat cells. And, you know, you keep getting bigger and bigger. But I already made a video that shows the difference between glucose getting into your muscle cells and fat cells. So if you want, you can just check it here. And another thing that can cause this weight gain is that patients know that they can have hypoglycemia. So they tend to eat more than what they need. And patients on these medications tend to not skip meals and sometimes eat many snacks during the day just in case. And, you know, the fear of hypoglycemia can get people to eat more and they will even gain more weight. But you know that most patients with type 2 diabetes do not need more weight. because that was your problem in the first place. So when you take these medications, they're not fixing your problem at all. Now, they're reducing blood sugar that can help you prevent some complications, but they're not fixing your problem at all. On my last video, I spoke about SGLT2 inhibitors, and I told you that those are fixing some of your problems. You are throwing the glucose into the toilet with those ones. You know, they're expensive, but at least they're fixing some of the problems. Too much glucose inside your body, getting rid of it. But this one does not. Just puts them into your cells. Now, there are some other things that I also don't like about these medications. Is that you know that they're forcing your beta cells to release insulin, right? So if you were someone whose beta cells were already, I mean, most of them were already gone, or you only have, let's say, 20% of your beta cells working. Now, when you take these medications and force them to release insulin without taking care of the real problem, you might destroy them even faster. So if patients just take these medications and do not take care of the other things, these medications will only work for a few years, and then you realize that your beta cell function will decline even faster, and after some time they're gone and you need insulin. So these medications will never be the first line therapy for type 2 diabetes. And lastly, there are some studies that show that these medications can increase cardiovascular events. Now, not all studies say this, but at least many of them. And when you compare them to medications like metformin or SGLT2 inhibitors that decrease your heart problems, then it doesn't make sense for you to take these ones first. But you know, some patients take them without any problems. Like, for example, let's say that for you, for your case, you had enough beta cells and producing enough insulin. You only had problems with glucose metabolism, and there were not enough ATP to push them. There were not enough ATP to close these channels and this one, and then make sure that the cells release insulin. Then these medications can work for you for a long time, because your problem was not insufficient insulin. Or if you're someone with good beta cells, they have insulin, but these channels are less sensitive to ATP. If they become less sensitive to ATP, then when you take these medications, they will just work wonderfully for a long time, for many years. So, you know, it depends. But for most people, these medications are not their first choice. Not first and not second. Now, there are other things that might happen for some people, like nausea, you know, diarrhea, or allergy. But these are not only for these medications. Like, other medications can also cause those things. So I did not put them here in the list. Now, let me ask you one question. Do you think these medications can help people with type 1 diabetes? The answer is no, because I told you they force your beta cells to release insulin. But patients with type 1 diabetes, they don't have functional beta cells. The immune system destroys them. So for those patients, if they take these medications, it will not work. And even for some patients with type 2 diabetes that are at the last stage, that do not have a lot of functional beta cells, these medications will also not work well. Now, I hope now you know how these medications work and you can understand some of the pros and cons of taking them. Now, if you are taking these medications or you've taken them before, please write them in the comment section and tell us how many of these you have experienced. And for now, have a blessed week. Bye.